Dante, following on what Brother Wong said about the Pali translation, I was just thinking on what Dante say, for a person to have the right view, you need to listen to somebody else's voice. So I was just thinking, could it be because it is a Pali translation, I suppose it is translated from a sutta or somewhere or something like that. Because I was thinking, I don't know the Pali language that well, I think it can be something like a Chinese, something a word can mean two things. And I remember once I was reading about the Buddha going to a disciple's house by the name of Chunda to have his meal, you know. And then I think that was when Buddha's demise was initiated, because he was poisoned from the food that was offered to him. And the commentary was said that the word mentioned in Pali can mean two things. It can mean the pork that was served to the Buddha, or it can also mean that there was this vegetation that was given to the pig as food, you know. So I was just wondering, I was just trying to digest, like a person's right view, you have to depend on another person's voice. How does that, I was just thinking, I'm trying to grasp that part.
This, depending on another person's voice, means hearing the Dhamma from somebody else, okay? So, basically it means hearing the Dhamma rather than meditation. And hearing the Dhamma can mean actually listening to somebody speak it or studying it in the books. And these suttas that have been handed down to us over 2,500 years from the Buddha's time, initially was transmitted orally. The Buddha chose to transmit his teachings by word of mouth orally, because he saw that that was the best way to transmit his teachings. Because during the Buddha's time and after it, there were thousands and thousands of monks, and they all chanted these suttas the same way. They repeated the suttas exactly as it was handed down. But later, from the year, from about 500 years after the Buddha's passing away, people started to write books, and the Mahayana books started with books, in book form. That is why you look into the Mahayana texts at the end of the suttas, they encourage people to write down the suttas and distribute, transmit the suttas. But you know, during the Buddha's time, there were no books, that's why the Mahayana suttas appeared later, not during the Buddha's time. Because it was handed down by word of mouth, it was very pure. Nobody could alter it. Whereas if you write books, people can write, each person can write a different book, or different interpretation, but when it's handed down, it is exactly as spoken by the Buddha, so it is quite pure. The only problem nowadays is the translation. But then the translations of it, either in English or Chinese or Thai or Burmese, the differences are not much. You could say, even if it is 95% accurate, that is good enough for you to become an Arya. Like these commentaries, actually we should not depend on commentaries, because the Buddha said that his words, that we should neither add to his words or subtract from his words. Don't add to what the Buddha said, and don't subtract from what the Buddha said. Just take his words exactly as handed down to us over the years. Then if you study his words, you get an understanding. And when you get an understanding, then you can tell the difference. What is the right Dhamma, what is not the right Dhamma. And then when you read later books like the Abhidhamma and the Mahayana books and all that, then only you can see the contradiction. But unless you have a good understanding of the early suttas, then you cannot see the contradiction. So the point is not to think whether they are accurate and all that. Just go into the suttas and study them. And after you study them and you have an understanding, then you judge for yourself. You see, as far as this last meal of the Buddha, the Buddha had been persuaded many times by Mara to enter Nibbana. But the Buddha said, no, I will not enter Nibbana until my teachings have spread and the Sangha of monks is strong. And then when I have finished my work, then only I will enter Nibbana. So the Mara, he asked the Buddha many times until when the Buddha was 80 years old, then the Buddha agreed to enter Nibbana. So when the Buddha agreed to enter Nibbana, that means his time was up. Whether he ate anything or did not eat anything, he will still enter Nibbana on that day. So it doesn't matter what he ate. But when that man Sunda served this food to the Buddha, and then the Buddha told Ananda to tell this Sunda, because after eating the food, the Buddha will pass away. So the Buddha was afraid that this Sunda will have a lot of remorse. Oh, I fed this food to the Buddha, and then the Buddha passed away. Maybe it was poison. But the Buddha said, tell him, don't think like that. The Buddha said, two meals given to the Buddha are the highest merit. One is the meal that he takes and then he becomes enlightened. The second is he takes that meal, then he enters Parinibbana. These two are the greatest merit. So Ananda was asked to tell that to Chunda so that he would not have any remorse. So it's not that the food was poison or whatever, it's just that the Buddha's time was right. Was time for him to go. Whatever food he took also, he will still die. Mm.